Why are you bothering yourself with all this your lineage and everything. Then he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَرَحَ بِالْإِيمَانِ مَنْ كَانَ النَّاسِ يُسَمِّنَهُ وَضِيعًا إِذَا كَانَ مُؤْمِنًا. Allah has raised the people who are low in lineage because of the iman. And then Imam continues, وَوَضَعَ بِالْكُفْرِ مَنْ كَانَ in the nas yusammunahu sharifan idha kana kafiran. And whoever was honorable in the eyes of people in terms of lineage, Allah has made them debased. Why? Because of their kufr. And Imam continues, he says, فَلَيْسَ لِأَحَدٍ فَضْلٌ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا بِالتَّقْوَىٰ. Nobody has superiority over the other except by being God-aware. It doesn't matter which family you're from, it doesn't matter who your parents are, it's being God-aware. And you find lots of hadith, Imam Ali, in talking about the muttaqin, a very powerful letter, a khutbah that he writes on the muttaqin, and we should refer to it, the sifat of the muttaqin, a lovely letter. Anyway, Salman al-Farsi was sitting with the companions one day, and they were in a gathering, and some of the companions were saying, I am so-and-so, I'm from so-and-so family, this is my origin. And they're all boasting. Then it comes to Salman. And they ask him, Man anta wa man abuka wa ma asluk? Who are you? And who's your father? And what's your origin? Note that Salman was a convert from Persia. It's Salman al-Farsi, Salman al-Muhammad. And then Salman answers. He says, أنا سلمان بن عبد الله كنت ضالا فهداني الله بمحمد وكنت عاهلا فأغناني الله بمحمد وكنت مملوكا فأعتقني الله بمحمد صلى الله عليه وآله.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
سلمان says, I am Salman, son of the servant of Allah. I was misguided, but Allah guided me by Muhammad. I was needy, and Allah made me free of need by Muhammad. I was a slave, and Allah made me free by Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
How many of us are still slaves while we profess Islam? Just look at Karbala. In the enemy lines, there were people who knew Imam Hussein was right, who knew the whole Quran by heart. But yet, because of them being slaves to the dunya, them being slaves to what others think of them, them being slaves to power and wealth. Look at Umar Asad, for example. He knew Imam Hussein is on the right. He didn't want to fight him, but because of rage. And we need to ponder to ourselves. Sometimes there's something wrong going on, but we are slaves to what people think of us. We are slaves to, what will that person say to me? What will that person say? Or we are slaves to, maybe I'll lose my job. We shouldn't be slaves. And then this gathering where Salman is sitting, the Prophet then passes by and he asks, what's going on? So Salman says, look, this is going on and this is what I reply. Then the Prophet says, Ya ma'ashira Quraysh, inna hasab al-rajul deenu. O people of the Quraysh, the lineage of the honor of a person is in his religion. Wa muruwatuhu khuluqu, and his chivalry, his status is because of his akhlaq. And the Prophet continues, Wa asluhu aqluhu, where he's from is his intellect. We may have the best of positions, the best of families, but if our aql isn't on the right, then what use is it? Prophet continues. قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلِّ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The Prophet quotes this verse that we just talked about. ثُمَّ قَالَ النَّبِيُّ لِسَلْمَانَ لَيْسَ لِأَحَدٍ مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ عَلَيْكَ فَضْلٌ إِلَّا بِتَقْوَى اللَّهِ. None of these people have superiority over you except the person who is God. وإن كان التقوى لك عليهم فأنت أفضل. If you have more taqwa than them, then you are more superior than them. And this is the simple message of Islam. To break away from all these idols that we've created. To be God weary. And that is what makes us closer to Allah. That is the merit that brings us closer to Allah. And we must visualize that at the time the Prophet came, the people were very proud of their lineage and very proud they would go and boast about it. Of course, if we go to Karbala, if we go after Karbala, Imam Zain al-Abidin in his khutbah talks that I am the son of the best of creations, and I am the son of Fatima, and I am the son of, my uncle is Ja'far. But we must know that these people that he was talking to, they were very ignorant and they weren't taking the message. So he had to use the words that they were speaking. But now Imam is addressing us, Ahlul Bayt are addressing us, that don't fall into this trap. Be muttaqi, be God-weary. One day, a man came to Imam Rida alayhi salam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Who we just celebrated his birthday a few days ago, wiladat. And we must take lessons from their lives. It's not good talking about Ahlul Bayt, no good praising Ahlul Bayt if we don't become like the Ahlul Bayt. The Ahlul Bayt wanted us to become like them. People were following Imam Ali one day. And they were following him, and Imam Ali turns back and says, who are you? They say that we're Shia. And he looks at them and he says, really? You don't have the sifat of the Shia. The Shia are such that their faces are pale, their lips are parched from fasting and dhikr, their bodies are thin from fasting. They can see the realities. So it's not good just talking about the Ahlul Bayt. Rather we should be implementing, becoming like the Ahlul Bayt. So a man came to him and said, والله ما على وجه الأرض رجل أشرف منك أباه. Man came to him and said, by God, none is better than you. He's telling the Imam, the eighth Imam, none is better than you in lineage. You are the best in lineage. And it was true. But what does Imam answer? He answers, فقال تقوى شرفه. Their badge of honor was their taqwa, their being God. It wasn't because they were from Bani Hashim. It wasn't because of who their lineage was. It was because of their taqwa. They were the best of creation on this earth. They were the most obedient to Allah. Imam continues. وَطَاعَةُ اللَّهِ and the obedience of Allah covered them. فَقَالَ لَهُ آخر. Another man told Imam Rida, he said, أَنْتَ وَاللَّهِ خَيْرُ النَّاسِ. You are by Allah the best of people. Then Imam gets a bit agitated. He says, لَا تَحْلَفْ يَا هَذَا. Don't swear by Allah or this person. خَيْرٌ مِنِّي مَنْ كَانَ أَتْقَى لِلَّهِ تَعَالَى. Better than me. And note the Imam is of a very high status, yet he says, better than me is the person who is more God-weary than me. And this is a lesson. Sometimes we get too proud of ourselves. We think that, oh, we are Muslim, oh, we are Shia, and we get, and Shaitan loves this, when we think of ourselves too good, and he reduces us in status. And because of this mentality, and we think that we are better than others, we don't really progress. But look at the humbleness that Imam has. Imam says that the better person than me is the person who has taqwa. وَأَطْوَعُ لَهُ and who is more obedient to Allah than me. وَاللَّهُ مَا نُسِخَتْ هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا لِتَعَرَفُ. And Allah hasn't abrogated this verse that we have made you tribes and nations so that we may know one another. And the best of you is the person who is God. The Ahlul Bayt used to emphasize this. Imam Sajjad alayhi salam. Talking to Allah and he fell into a state, and a person comes to him and he says, you're the best of people, why are you crying? And Imam rebukes him. He says, even we have to talk to him. We have to cry. We have to ask Allah for forgiveness. But Islam is a religion of practice. It isn't used just reading the Quran. It isn't used without practicing it. Come and qari al-Quran wa al-Quran al-Alim. How many are reciting of the Quran and the Quran blesses him? How many times a person takes up the Quran, reads the verses, and doesn't implement them? Look at the stories within the Quran. So many lessons. So many lessons, for example, of the prophets. The prophets underwent what we go through in everyday life. Some of the prophets lost family. Some of the prophets were left aside by family. Some of us are left aside by family. Some of the prophets lost everything they had. Some of us sometimes, we are tested with loss of wealth, loss of health, loss of some. Look at Prophet Ayyub alayhi salam. He was tested to the core. He lost everything. He was a rich man. He lost everything. He lost his health, he lost his wealth, he lost his children. Yet he is grateful to Allah. There are lessons in this. Look at Prophet Musa, for example, often mentioned in the Quran. When Prophet Musa's mother put him into the casket and led him down the river, how much trust did the mother have? Imagine putting your child down the river. And look at Allah's plan, right to the enemy's doorstep. What would we have done? We would have been worried. We say, Ya Allah, musibata. You know, this has happened to us right to the enemy's doorstep. Have trust in Allah. Allah mentions, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ. We will most definitely test you. With what? With a bit. With a bit of fear. With a bit of loss of wealth. With a bit of loss of offspring. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Give glad tidings to those who are patient. We need to learn lessons from this. And Musa, as he grows up in the palace of Fir'aun, it reaches a stage where he is interceding between a few people. فَوَكَزَ مُوسَى فَقَضَى عَلَيْهِ. Musa punched one of them and they died. And then it proceeds, they want to kill him, Fir'aun's people. فَخَرَجَ خَائِفًا يَتَرَقَّبَ. He leaves the city fearful. He's scared of his life, but he has trust in Allah. He goes, he reaches Madian, he meets Prophet Shu'ayb. He tells him the story. He lives with Prophet Shu'ayb for a while, 8 to 10 years. He marries his daughter. He proceeds, he's getting closer to Allah. He then reaches the mountain. He goes to the burning bush. Allah tells him, إِخْلَعَنْ عَلَيْكَ إِنَّكَ فِي الْوَالِ الْمُقَدَّسِ طُوَى. Remove your attachments. You have come to the holy valley. And Allah talks to him, إِنَّنِي أَنَ اللَّهِ. Allah is talking to Prophet Musa. Read this in the Quran. Take lessons. There's so many lessons in the Quran that we can take from. Then Musa continues and he goes forward. He then goes back to Fir'aun. This is a lesson for us. We sometimes are scared to face the reality. We're scared to stand up for the truth. Prophet Musa, he was a bit scared, but he asks Allah for help. And Allah helps him. And he goes to Fir'aun and he talks to him and he argues with him and they have the day where they have all the magicians come together. And this is a very powerful story. All the magicians come together and they ask Fir'aun very arrogantly. The magicians who are Ahlul Dunya, they're very attached to this world. They ask Fir'aun, do you have any reward if we win this? He says, قَالَ نَعَمْ وَأَنْتُمْ مِنَ الْمُقَرَّبِينَ. You are close to me. If you win, you'll be close to me. Imagine this. The king gives you anything you want and he gives you status. He gives you whatever you want. So the magician says, okay, we'll continue. And they're very happy. They want a good reward. And then they ask of him, so either you cast down or we will cast down the sticks and strings. Prophet Musa says, Antum al-Qur'an. You cast it down. This is all in the Quran, Surah Taha. Lovely story. They cast it down, Prophet Musa then cast it down, and Prophet Musa's stick eats up all of their stuff. And they are shocked because they know what they're doing is magic, it's an illusion. But what Prophet Musa did was out of this world. And they just fall into sajda. How many times we realize the truth but don't accept it? And they had a big reward, they're losing out a lot. And not only that, Prophet Fir'aun tells them, هُوَ كَبِيرُكُمُ الَّذِي عَلَّمَكُمْ. He is the big one. He taught you magic. And then he says, لَأُقَطِّعَنَّ أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ مِنْ خِلَافٍ وَلَأُصَلِّبَنَّكُمْ. I will cut your hands and your legs from the opposite sides, and then I will crucify you. What do the magicians say? They've lost a lot. They've lost their wealth, they've lost their status, and now they're threatened to be cut off and crucified. What do they say? Say, no problem. لَا غَيْرَ لَنَا. No problem. Do what you want. We آمَنَّا بِرَبِّ مُوسَى وَهَارُونَ. We believe in the Lord of Musa and Harun. And this is the truth. This is the reality. When you look for the truth and you realize what the truth is, just need to submit. This is what the magicians did. Despite all that, they were Ahlul Dunya, they were at the core of it, but they realized the truth. We need to ask ourselves, do we first, have we actually gone and sought for the truth? Have we looked for the truth, or are we comfortable where we are? And when we do see the truth, are we comfortable enough not to accept it? Because it's scary sometimes, you know, to accept the truth. It breaks these idols, it may break relations, it may break, you may lose status amongst people. And they lost everything and they submitted to the Lord. And then Prophet Musa continues, his story continues. He takes the Bani Israel. Now he's going towards the sea, and behind him is Fir'aun chasing him. In front of him is what seems like doom, and behind him is what seems like doom. And the Bani Israel are scared. They think there's a big, huge sea in front of us, and behind us is the army. We're doomed, you know. Why did you bring us here, Musa? The Prophet Musa says, have trust in Allah. This is very powerful. At times we're tested, we think that there is no hope. Who is the one who provided for you when you had nothing? When you are in the stomachs of your mothers, when you had nothing, Allah is the one who provided for you. When you thought that nothing is going to happen, no good, we need to reflect on our lives. We just need to sit down and reflect. Sometimes we are faced with situations where we think that there is no solution. But looking back at this, that what happened, realize whatever happened is for the best. You just need to trust Allah. That mentality that the prophets used to have is so powerful. We need to adopt it. So anyway, Prophet Musa goes, he hits his staff on the river. The river spreads. He goes through, the river comes back drowning Fir'aun and his army, and they reach the other side. And they reach the other side. He goes to the mountain to get the commandments. He comes back down. And Bani Israel, what do? They start worshipping a calf. And in this, the whole lessons dotted throughout these stories in the Quran. Very powerful to put you in your mindset to face life. Look at Yusuf, alayhi salam. What a beautiful story. The whole surah of Yusuf. نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنُ الْقَصَصِ. We narrate to you the best of stories. إِذْ قَالَ يُوسُفُ لِأَبِيهِ إِنِّي أَغَافِلُ. As Prophet Yusuf is talking to his father, he says, I see in my dream, أَحَدَ أَشَرَ كَوْكَبًا وَالشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ رَأَيْتُهُمْ لِي سَاجِدِينَ. I saw 11 stars, the sun and moon prostrating to me. The story of Yusuf, very powerful again. Look at the attitude, the proactive attitude. Prophet Yusuf is thrown into the well. What would we do if our brothers, our own blood, threw us into the well? What do we think? We think bad of them, you know, we hate them, we curse them, say, how could they do this? And we feel sad for ourselves in the bottom of the well. What did Prophet Yusuf do? He adopted a proactive attitude. He wasn't reactive. See, many a time we are reactive. Whatever happens to us, we react to that situation. Proactive is taking control of your own actions, of your own feelings. And the only thing that you really have control over is how you perceive life, is how you face life. You can't control the weather, you can't control what others do to you. You can to some extent, but the main thing that you have control over is your attitude to life. And that's so powerful. Look at Prophet Yusuf in that well. He thanks Allah, he talks to Allah, he's in a conversation with Allah. And then he gets saved, he goes to Misr, he goes to Egypt. He is taken as a slave, yet a positive attitude by Prophet Yusuf. And then he is accused of something he didn't do. Yet, he doesn't waver in his trust. He's thrown into prison. Yet because of his proactive attitude, because he had control over how he perceives everything, he changed the whole atmosphere of the prison, and they all started loving him. Such profound it is when we change what we have within ourselves. Imam Ali says, أَتَزْعَمُ أَنَّكَ جُرْمٌ صَغِيرٌ وَفِيكَ انْتَوَى الْعَالَمُ الْأَكْبَرُ. Do you think that you are this small entity, whereas within you is an entire universe? We need to tap into that universe that we have. Let's go to Karbala, where we see the Ibrahim of Karbala, where we see this man going towards the people with his 6-month-old baby. And he goes towards the people. He asks, "Oh people, can you not see the 6-month-old child?" And the people are crying. They're all seeing the 6-month-old child. And one of them just takes a 3-pronged arrow and aims it to Ali al-Asr. How hard-hearted these people were. And look at the Ismail of Karbala, how he sacrificed what was dear to him for Allah's sake. And they shot an arrow at the baby, killing him. And Imam Hussein is standing there thinking, what should I do? How can I take this child in front of the mother? Imam Hussein walks front and back, thinking, how do I take this child to his mother? He walks back and front saying, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. But the Ibrahim of Karbala had this strength, he had this trust in Allah, and he takes the child. But if we look at Imam Hussein, his last breaths, when Shimmer was on his back and he is being slaughtered, he looks up to the skies and smiles. This is the love that Imam Hussein has with Allah. Poet says, تَرَبْتُ الْخَلْقَ ظُرًّا لِكَيْ أَرَاكَ وَأَيْتَمْتُ إِلَى إِيَالِي لِكَيْ أَرَاكَ فَإِنْ قَتَّرُونِي إِرْبًا إِرْبًا لَمَا كَانَفُ عَلِي إِلَى سِوَاكَ. He says, I've left everything for you, O Allah. I've made my children yatim for your sake, O Allah. Even if I were to be cut into small pieces, I would not love anyone but you. We pray to Allah to give us this love. We pray to Allah to become like the Ahlul Bayt and to embody the akhlaq of the Ahlul Bayt. Ala ya'rifu Allah ala al-qawmi al-zalimin. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala al-tayyibin al-tahirin.
Tibbu Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allah
salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Dua hai par intiqal Ahmad Ali Raza sahab ki taufeeqat mein izafa farmaye. Ameen. Ek momina Dr. Fozia Zahra ne dua ki request ki hai par intiqal is momina ki aur inki family ki duaen duaon aur haajat ko qubool farmaye. Par intiqal tamam momineen ki duaon ko mustajab farmaye. Ameen. Tamam momineen se guzarish hai ہمارے مرحومین تمام مرحومین کے لیے ایک سورہ فاتحہ اور 3 مرتبہ سورہ اخلاص کی تلاوت فرمائیں۔